So males often possess extremely impressive physical traits, and the females pay attention to them. They prefer to mate with the most impressive males. But why? Why should they care? Here we get into the heart of female choice. Females choose their males on various possible criteria. The first is that females may prefer wealthy males. And I'll give you an example from insects. Let's look at these. They're called hanging flies. And what we have is a male who has captured a very large, juicy lunch. And he's been displaying his lunch on a twig in an area that he knows females like. A female comes up, sees he has this big, tasty meal, and then he offers it to her. And so she then gets to feed on this tasty meal, and in return, she allows him to mate with her. So females prefer males that offer larger nuptial gifts. And the larger the gift, the more eggs they're able to produce. So she wants a male who's got a big meal ready because she can convert that food into eggs and into offspring. So she benefits by receiving that larger gift. Crickets are even more direct and to the point. Male crickets go around and they'll actually deposit spermatophore on the ground. That spermatophore has their sperm in it, but it also has some protein and various other nutrients in it. So the females walk around until they find the largest spermatophore they can find. They then insert it themselves into their own reproductive tract, and the female that gets the largest spermatophore from the male, she gets nutrients, again, that she can convert into eggs. So in both of these cases, the females are receiving from the males resources that they can then convert into more offspring for themselves. The females get more offspring by choosing males with larger nuptial gifts or larger spermatophores. Next is that females may prefer genetically superior males. And for this, let's look at the lions. Lions vary in the coloration of their manes. Some of the manes in our study area are quite dark. So this guy has an impressive dark mane. And this guy is more kind of like a beach bum over here with a blonde mane. And it turns out that the color of the mane is a reliable indication of how well nourished he is, okay? How much he's been able to eat lately, and also of his underlying quality. He's got a better diet. He's got more testosterone. He's more dominant in his behavior. And he's better able to survive wounding than a blonde male would be. And as a consequence, these males can live longer, stay longer in the pride, protect their wives against takeovers and infanticide in the future. So the offspring of these males have higher condition and better survival. So females should prefer these dark mane males over blonde mane males. And the important thing here is that the trait is a very costly trait. This is actually telling the female, look, the fact that I can go around with this big, heavy, dark sweater, even in a tropical climate, tells you that I am a high-quality male, okay? The mane is so costly that it serves as an honest indicator of quality. Only the studs can take the heat. So, let's see how the females actually respond to this. We brought out 4 life-size toy lions to the Serengeti National Park a few years ago. We wanted to give females a chance to choose between 2 males at a time. And we varied each dummy according to the size and coloration of its mane. So short blonde male, we called Lothario. Short black mane male, we called Romeo. The long blonde male, we called Fabio. And the long dark mane male, we called Julio. Okay? So we're going to set them out 2 at a time and see if females might prefer long over short, so Julio over Romeo, or dark over blonde, Julio versus Fabio, okay? So here is a female lion. She's actually in heat right now, and she's eager to mate with a male, but she hasn't got a partner with her right now. So we've attracted her up to the dummies, which we've set out in front of our car, and there's Fabio on the right, a blonde mane male, and he's not really as exciting for her as the black mane male. There's Julio on the left. She's a bit puzzled as to why he's just sitting there, because she's used to getting a lot of attention when she's in heat. But she's very interested. She's waving her tail around. She really thinks Julio's pretty cool, and she makes her choice. We've done a number of these experiments, and every time we've done it, just about, the female prefers the black mane male over the blonde mane male. We also set the dummies out in front of males to see how they would respond. So here we have a male lion given a choice. You can see his behavior is very different. The female was flirtatious around those new males. This guy is extremely cautious. And if you've ever wondered what pussyfooting means, this is pussyfooting. He just doesn't want to be seen sneaking up behind these two males. We actually edited that, and it took him several minutes to make these last few meters up to the male. And he finally makes his choice. Okay. And realizes that that's just a toy. But up until then, he was actually being very, very brave, because if those had been two real male lions, they would have killed him, two against one. So here we have the summary of all the experiments we did with these dummies over the years. And when we gave them a choice between dark manes and light manes, the females almost always preferred the dark mane, a very strong preference for a dark mane. Whereas the males, who are in a risky situation, they're very intimidated by the dark mane male, and they check out the light mane male instead. That's the weaker opponent. We were a little bit surprised that the females were so focused on color rather than length, because some males have longer manes than others. And the males were pretty concerned about mane length, and they went to the shorter mane, whereas the females didn't always go towards the longer. They just had a slight preference for length. And when we think about this, you know, in humans, the equivalent of the mane in humans is not our hair, it's the men's beards, okay? And, you know, having a really long beard isn't necessarily very sexy, right? These guys aren't sexy, right? Neither of those guys. They're not sexy at all, right? So the fact is that the females are cueing in on the trait that would tell them who the strongest male is right now, and that seems to be the color of the mane rather than its length. So, as we're on this topic of things that indicate quality, and I just showed you a very handsome movie star, you know, that doesn't last a whole lifetime. If you think about some of the really handsome leading men of Hollywood, like Harrison Ford, he was a good-looking guy in his mid-30s, right? But maybe not so attractive, you know, as he reached his 70s. Or Elvis, you know, there's young, sexy Elvis, young man. And Fat Elvis just doesn't quite have the same sex appeal, right? And so one of the things that is worth keeping in mind about age and attractiveness is the fact that men are producing sperm throughout their whole lives, okay? And we undergo this mitosis that will eventually lead to the cells that go on to become sperm, okay? And this occurs throughout life. Because this is happening constantly, okay, sperm can accumulate more and more mutations. So those special cells that undergo repeated mitosis in the testes every now and then make a mistake, and through time there'll be more and more mutations present in the male sperm. And this is emphasized by a recent study looking at the effect of paternal age on the risks of certain kinds of autism spectrum disorders, which seem to be the result of point mutations, okay? And here we have more and more signs of these mutations in older fathers, okay? So as male age goes up, there are relatively few of these mutations, but with age, by the time men are in their mid-40s, their mutation rate has already gone significantly higher than it was in men in their early 20s, okay? So thinking about how unhealthy the sperm would be of old men, I mean, it's already pretty high by men in their mid-40s. When you see couples like this, and you have this guy, J. Howard Marshall, at 89, who got married to Anna Nicole Smith, who was 26 years of age, and more recently, there's this guy, Hugh Hefner, who's 86, getting married to Crystal Miller, who's also 26. I mean, these guys have got wretched, horrible, mutant sperm. What could be in it for them? I wonder. Well, it turns out that J. Howard Marshall was worth $500 million, and Hugh Hefner's worth $43 million. So that's probably why men want to accumulate a whole lot of wealth in their age, so they can still maintain something to compensate for the fact that genetically they're not very healthy anymore. So by preferring wealthy or superior males, in most cases, females can have more and or better surviving offspring.